character studies in Colossians chapter 4, looking at the family snapshot of the different types of people that were involved in ministry along with the Apostle Paul. So Colossians chapter 4. Let's read verses 7 through the end once again. Colossians 4, verse number 7 says, "All my state or affairs shall Tychicus declare unto you, who was a beloved brother and a faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord, whom I have sent unto you for the same purpose, that he might know your estate and comfort your hearts. With Onesimus, a faithful and beloved brother, who was one of you, they shall make known unto you all things which are done here. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, saluteth you, and Marcus, sister's son to Barnabas, touching whom you receive commandments, if he come unto you, receive him. And Jesus, which is called Justice, who are of the circumcision. These only are my fellow workers unto the kingdom of God, which have been a comfort unto me." Verse 13, "Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you always, laboring fervently for you in prayers, that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. For I bear him record that he hath a great zeal for you, and them that are in Laodicea, and them in Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician, and Demas greet you. Salute the brethren which are in Laodicea, and Nymphas, and the church which is in his house. And when this epistle is read among you, cause it be read also in the church of the Laodiceans, and that ye likewise read the epistle from Laodicea. And say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which thou hast received in the Lord, that thou fulfill it. The salutation by the hand of me, Paul. Remember my bonds. Grace be with you. Amen." And may the Lord add his blessing into his holy word this morning. So we continue today. We've been looking at these different characters, these different individuals who were either coming from Paul to bring what Paul was going through back to them with the letter at the beginning here with Tychicus and with Onesimus. They coming from Paul, and then Paul has these other friends that are with him that we looked at last week. We looked at Onesimus a couple weeks ago, the fugitive from his master, who would be profitable, and he was sent back to his master in the book of Philemon. He would be profitable unto Paul and would be profitable unto the church in Colossae. And then last week we looked at Aristarchus and Marcus. We had these two different people, Aristarchus being the stalwart, the guy that jumps in and just gets involved and does everything, and we have Marcus, or John Mark, who, being younger, he couldn't handle the rigors, but here, some 12 years later, he is found to be a faithful minister with Paul, and being deemed that you pay attention to what I say, receive him. No matter what you've heard in the past, John Mark has grown up now, and he is a minister of Christ. And then we looked at Jesus, or Justice. Nothing else is written. He's the simple man, the friendly man that just followed Paul. I think I said something about he would be just like your average church member. He would be just a normal person that was there and was faithful, and he trusted in what Paul had written, and he trusted in what Jesus Christ had done. Now we move on here. He says at the end of verse 11, these only, who, he says, who are of the circumcision, these only are my fellow workers into the kingdom of God, which have been a comfort unto me. They weren't the only workers. They were the only workers who were Jews, who were of the circumcision, who were of help to him. Now, we turn our attention on the next several people, mainly Epaphras today. We look at Epaphras, Luke, Luke, Demas, Nymphas, and Archippus. In the next couple of weeks, we look at these. These are all Gentile converts from the ministry of Paul. And so he holds them up in the same esteem as he holds up the Jews that were of the circumcision. They were the ones, remember the circumcision or the Jews were the ones that first had the oracles of God given to them. They were responsible for keeping the word of God, and the word of God had now been spread to, at the time, the outermost parts of the earth. All the way to Spain, Paul had brought the gospel. And then because of what Paul and the people after him did, we are the beneficiaries of that gospel. It's even reached over to the United States. And we can thank God and his grace for that happening. We look at Epaphras today. He says we have Epaphras. By the way, Epaphras means a follower of Aphrodite, pagan god. Now, I don't see any record that he was that, but more than likely he was a follower of idols, and he was saved under the Apostle Paul, who led him to the true God, Jesus Christ, and away from the idols that were. And we know what was happening in Colossae. Colossae was being attacked from the inside and the outside with false religion, false beliefs, and they wanted to believe in anything but Jesus. And many of those that did believe in Jesus just thought that he was part of the Pleroma, which we'll look at that word in a couple minutes again, as being just one of the manifestations or emanations of God. So here was Epaphras, who now believe that Jesus was the one true God.
Amen.
And he became a minister of that one true God. Now we get to Archippus at the end here. Archippus, he and Epaphras were both ministers, both gospel preachers in the church of Colossae. But what happened with Archippus, it was Epaphras with Paul, and he was Archippus by himself leading up that church, and he needs this letter at the end here. He needs Paul's admonition to go on, to fulfill the ministry that God has given him, to stand tough in the times that he was facing. But we'll cover that in more detail next week or so. Oh, look at Epaphras. Epaphras, he was a native of Colossae. He was a servant of Christ, a preacher of the gospel, and he faithfully served his master and Lord, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
What a testimony that he had.
Amen.
Those words alone are enough to fill heaven's glory. Those words are enough to look at you, yourself, look at others, look and see what they are. A preacher of the gospel, faithfully serving his Lord and Master. That's a good description. Jesus Christ, he bought us out of slavehood from the world. He bought us out of the marketplace, and he bought us for himself. We are no longer under our master. Those masters are the world, the flesh, and the devil. When no longer under the bondage to them, we are bound by a new master, a benevolent master, the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is the picture we have of Epaphras, one who was a worshiper of Aphrodite, now a slave, a doulos, a slave of Jesus Christ, his new master. We saw that earlier with Onesimus. He was a runaway slave, ran away from his worldly master. We saw that a lot of people will run away from the true master, God, and they need to run into him instead. So Epaphras, who was one of you, one of Colossae, receive him. I looked at the wrong verse. A servant of Christ saluteth you. blue chew. It's not just a, like what we think of it, a salutation. Is that he's sending his sincere love and affection to them. He's with me here right now. He's ministering with me, but you guys are in his heart. And he gives his greatest regards to you. What a picture that was, though being some 1,000 or 700 miles away from his hometown, his home church, he saluteth them. How did he salute them? His salutation wasn't just in word. His salutation was indeed as well. Indeed, indeed. Look what he says. He saluteth you always, laboring fervently for you in prayers.
Amen.
Being with Paul, he never forgot his little flock in Colossae. Even though he had Archippus there to take over, he never forgot, even being that long distance away from them, he strove. That's what laboring means. Fighting. Striving with God. Oh God, protect that flock. I know that I'm here and I know there's false teachers and there are wolves there, but Lord, protect them. And God did for the time providentially protect them. But later on, we would see all of these churches that were mentioned in the Bible are now relics. They're all gone as physical places. But yet, the legacy of these men continues on. We have something greater than their physical location there. We have God's Word, which preserves for us His desire, His plans for us. So he was laboring or striving fervently for you in prayers. Why? What was his prayer? Oh Lord, bless them with a new building. Lord, bless them. They all need new motorcycles and cars. And, you know, their chariots aren't quite working the way they should be. And, oh, this guy's horse is getting old. He's probably going to be turned into a glue factory. But he prays this for them, that ye may stand. Stand. That to stand, you have to have something firm to stand on. That ye stand, how does he say it? He says that ye may stand perfect. And he says, and complete, which they're both very similar, but just slightly different. I like that, those words that like that. Quick reading, it says, but saying the same thing. But the term for being perfect, is teleos, that you're complete. In Christ, this perfection has nothing to do with you. This perfection has to do with trusting in the imputed righteousness of Christ. We stand or sit together today as believers in Jesus Christ, not by our works, but we stand here because of what Christ has done. He's given us his perfect righteousness. Jesus Christ is their head in his own righteousness. You are full. When God saved you through his Son, Jesus Christ, you got everything that you need for life and godliness. At least that's what the Apostle Peter tells us in 2 Peter chapter 3. You have everything you have. You have complete salvation. Now the next part here, he says, and that you may stand perfect and complete. complete. Here's the same word we saw back in chapter 1 of Colossians, dealing with the fullness of God. This is the pleroma, being God, being Jesus Christ, being the full essence of God, and not just one part of the equation. You, likewise, Paul's desire is that you be perfect and be made complete. We could also phrase that as that you would have full assurance. How do you have this full assurance? You have full supply. That's what it means to be overflowing, like a net that is overfilled, or a cup. Did you ever get a soda at McDonald's or someplace, and you fill it up too much, and you have the foam that comes up over the top? That's what this completeness is in Christ. You have everything and more. But yet, this part here has something that we need to do, is you need to be filled with the knowledge of God, even to overflowing. You know, they say that all things are okay in moderation. You know, that goes with anything in the world. But yet, God's desire for the Christian is to be overfilled with the knowledge of God. That's the one thing that can't hurt you. One thing that can always benefit you is that you know too much of the will of God. Think of all the damage that could do. If you drink too much milk, your bones are going to dry up. If you have too much vitamin C, something's going to happen. Too much vitamin D. You have too much cereal, you're going to have a wheat belly. You have too much of this, too much of that. Everything in moderation, but too much of the Word of God. And the knowledge of God will never be bad for you. You could tell me sometime where somebody was done wrong by having too much of the knowledge of God. I'll show you somebody that doesn't exist. Amen? What happens, though, and here's where we'll be getting to, is the protection of the sheep from the false prophets. Those false prophets, they tend not to have the knowledge of God, but they like to have a knowledge of themselves. And having power. We'll get to that later. So that you may be perfect and complete. Perfect, God's righteousness given to you, and complete, in this case, full assurance based on an addiction to the Word of God. It will never leave you high and dry, as many other things will do. That you may stand perfect and complete in what? The will of God. You ask, how do you know the will of God? To know the will of God. Sounds kind of simple and hard at the same time, does it not? You find the will of God by just indulging, overdosing yourself in God's word and the knowledge of Him. It doesn't hurt to do a proverb of the day. The proverbs are wonderful. Or read some portion of Scripture. That's not legalism. If you don't do that, you're going to die. But it will give better life when doing so. It's great. You read the proverbs, you find conflict throughout the proverbs. But the idea is that for a believer, those proverbs, in light of salvation, will give you peace. They'll give you enlightenment for how to live your life at the same time. I can't explain it too much. But the reality is God's word is incredible. And we so forsake it. We put it at second tier. Well, I have this, I have that, and then I have God's word. Should be the other way. It should be the top of the pyramid. God's word should dwell in the believer. That's exactly what back in chapter 3 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Or even in that case, it's overabounding wealth. It's not money. It's the word and the peace that comes from the word and the ability to stand because of that word. And let's move on here to verse number 13. It says, "For I bear him record." What a great testimony that is. The Apostle Paul, he was an eyewitness as well as an ear witness to Epaphras. The Apostle Paul, right there with him there, he could see that Epaphras' desire was for the people. He fervently prayed for them. And Paul knew personally of Epaphras' love for the people in Colossae and his zealous affection for the saints. There was nothing that could stop Epaphras. No matter what would happen, his desire was the welfare of the saints there in Colossae. He has a great zeal for you. "I bear him record that he hath a great zeal for you." What did this zeal encompass? This zeal encompassed their spiritual welfare. Above all things, that they would know Christ and him crucified. Amen. If Paul had written already to the Corinthians, "For I was determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified," this would be Epaphras' verse as well. No matter what happens, Jesus Christ is enough. He had their spiritual welfare in mind, that the gospel would continue with them. As we have seen throughout the whole letter, we know the false teachers were always there to overthrow the faith. They would even, Paul would say that they try to shipwreck the faith of some. We had those two characters, Alexander the coppersmith, would overthrow the faith, making people shipwrecked, without a place to anchor in. But let me say this, the one thing that can prevent false doctrine is the gospel. The gospel is where the rubber hits the road. If the gospel is given to you that's anything else but faith in Jesus Christ and Christ alone, it's a false gospel. We can start right there. If you hear anything else that adds to that gospel that you must do anything to receive salvation but believe, it's a false gospel. And that's the number one defense. False teachers, which he would be protecting them against, always bring this nasty three-letter word that's often used. You know what that is? It's spelled A-N-D. Jesus Christ and your baptism. Jesus Christ and circumcision. Jesus Christ and... you can add your own thing to it. There's even the talk of lordship salvation. You must believe Jesus Christ, and you must not only make him Savior, but make him Lord. Well, I really can't make Jesus Savior or Lord personally, but Jesus Christ showed his grace, showed the gospel was declared, and I can believe that. I don't have to make him Lord or make him Savior whatsoever. That would put me above him.
That's right.
Amen? Jesus Christ alone, through the Holy Spirit, the gospel is declared. You believe that you're sanctified and justified. Period. You get the gavel like a judge would have. Anything else added to it would be wrong, would be sin. Adding or subtracting from the gospel. So he had a great zeal for the Colossians, for their spiritual welfare, and that the gospel would continue with them. Division comes when you focus on other than the gospel. That's what the false prophets, the false teachers always would strive to do. They would grow in the grace of the gospel. Not only grow, but they would walk worthy of the gospel of Christ. We found that all through Paul's epistles. The doctrine is laid down of grace through faith, believing in Jesus Christ and nothing else. And because of that, now you're able to walk worthy of the calling of Christ. Without that, we can't walk. We can't do anything for salvation. And even sanctification begins and ends with the grace of God.
Amen.
It ends with keeping your eyes on Jesus. Amen. I love that. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full on his wonderful face. And the ways of earth will grow slowly dim. How's the last part going? In the light of his glory and grace. See, that's how we walk. Not because we're trying to please God, but we walk because God. Jesus Christ has become a savor unto God. We walk in him, and then we are an aroma before him. We trust him. We grow in him. We get filled up with his word and the knowledge of him. And then God enables us to walk worthy because of what he's done. He loved us first. 1 John 4:10, we love him because he loved us. That's how we show back. We walk. Our actions, when they're based on the word of God and the work of God, will only make us walk in that same way. So that their spiritual welfare, the gospel would continue with them, that they would grow in the grace of God, of the gospel, that they would walk worthy of God, and that they would have peace among themselves. You know, one of the most painful things that you see is when a church has a split. How do those things happen? It's because one says, I have this, I have that. Read the beginning of the book of James. That's where wars come amongst us. People are jealous because one person has one thing. I've seen churches split because some people didn't like the color of the carpet. Big deal, tear the carpet right out, throw the pews out, throw the chairs out. Let's be focused on what Christ did and grow from that.
Right.
That's what Epaphras' desire was, even though he was miles away from that church that he loved, those people that he loved. And look how it spreads as well. For I bear him record that he hath a great zeal for you and them that are in Laodicea and them in Hierapolis. Laodicea and Hierapolis were two other cities in the region in the Lycos Valley of what's modern-day Turkey today. And we know a lot about Laodicea in Revelation chapter 2. This is the unfaithful church. We don't know much about Hierapolis, but it was the twin city. You guys, Jim was from near the twin cities, right? St. Paul and what's the big one?
Minneapolis.
I couldn't think of it. Minneapolis and St. Paul, the twin cities. This is what Hierapolis and Laodicea, they were twin cities on the Lycos River. Colossae was at the northern part, or the headwaters of the Lycos River, and that water flew, it ran downward into Hierapolis and then into Laodicea. By the time the water got to Laodicea, it wasn't the cold, refreshing springs as it was upstream. So that's what happened there. But they were in the same region. We'll save Laodicea for another time in Revelation chapter 2 about what happened there. It's notorious because they didn't believe in Christ. And Jesus was left outside waiting. You call yourself Christians, let me in, because I don't hear anything about me, but about all about them. This is the same tragedy that would take place in Colossae. These cities were much like the cities along the Blackstone River or any other place. Worcester at the headwaters and Providence down below. There's a need for the ministry, for the gospel to go to these places. We're all like that. Actually, Laodicea was an industrial city, much like Worcester, Massachusetts. Very high in education, a lot of banking. They had textiles, was their main manufacturing thing, much like this area used to be. We can draw parallels of it. But yet, here was Epaphras, had a burden for his church there in Colossae, but not only them, he was fervent in prayer and zeal for those that were in Laodicea and Hierapolis. He would pray, Lord, send some churches. Send some ministers of the gospel to these locations. Let the word of God dwell richly in them as well. This is the picture that is portrayed by Epaphras, an otherwise unknown man in the course of the world today. If we go outside the world today, it's scary. Most people that you were to ask on a if we were to go out on a sidewalk someplace, ask them if they know who George Washington is. And I would bet over 50% of the people wouldn't know that he was our first president. And yet, ask Christians if they know who the Apostle Paul is. I bet a lot of people wouldn't know. But here is Epaphras, the unknown man in the world's eyes. But he had this zeal. He had this love. He had this passion for those in the church and for those around. May we grow in that same passion, that desire that people would know Jesus Christ, not only outside the church, but in the church as well. A lot of the church is in dire need of the gospel. They have everything else. They have the bells and whistles, but they don't have Jesus. Or at least the Jesus that's portrayed in the scriptures. They have other Jesus. The curly-haired male boyfriend Jesus is very popular today. But we worship the Jesus of the Bible, yes. Kind and compassionate. He gave his life on the cross. But if we go back to the first couple chapters here in the book of Colossians, the same Jesus was tough. He created the world. He has all power. He is the plorama, the fullness of God in all, and may he be the fullness of God in his church that is called by his name today. Amen. Salvation is good. Salvation is the most amazing miracle we could ever have.
Amen.
Why people are looking for greater miracles, I don't know. We're looking for the sun to stand still, the moon to go dark, and all this. And yes, there's going to be a one-time event where that will be happening. The sun will not shine, the moon will not give off her light. That's not an eclipse. That's a miraculous, supernatural judgment of God. But yet people are looking for all that stuff. Well, we just need to look and see who the real Jesus Christ is. Amen. May the gospel be the most important thing in our individual lives.
Amen.
And if it's not, here's how to make it that way. Take some time. 15 minutes away from the television, 15 minutes in the Bible. A few weeks later, It's going to be 30 minutes away from the television, 30 minutes in the Bible. Be filled with that knowledge of God.
Right.
If it comes right from the Bible, it's not going to kill you. It might actually save you.
Amen.
Amen. So that, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. It's only possible to believers. Nobody else can. That's a 24/7 operation. But praise God, Jesus fulfilled all that so we can now be at peace among ourselves. We can love the brethren. We can love our enemies as Christ loved them. Amen. God so loves us. Don't get over it. Get to know Him. Put your head in the Bible. I didn't hit myself this time, though, so. Amen. God gives us His miraculous peace that passeth all understanding.
Amen.
The overflow.